We are here at WPPI. I am joined by Sam Hurd. And today, we are going to be talking about Sam's migration from Nikon into the Canon R. Do you have anything to say about this?
It's been delightful.
We're filming a Wes Anderson-style short, so we are in a different mind space than we usually are. Yeah. A very strange and creative and symmetrical space.
Which this shot probably is not. In fact, there's a trash can behind us.
Yeah. But we did some really fantastic shots with this cart that you're probably seeing right now, and we're going to get into it. So do you want to kind of walk us through a little bit about your transition?
So I shot Nikon for about a decade and was always itching. Nikon was sort of the first DSLR that had sort of a mirrorless experience with their live view with the D4 years ago. And I loved shooting live view. That was almost exclusively how I shot more of my creative portrait stuff. Yeah. Not a lot of the like quick reaction storytelling, because you had to manual focus in live view back then.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I was always sort of itching for the jump to mirrorless when it was practical and like the camera bodies were there. And when the EOS R came out, it wasn't really on my radar because I was a Nikon shooter and wasn't really looking at Canon stuff. But for whatever reason, the EOS R, when it launched, just didn't get a lot of love. I think because it was really kind of handicapped in the video side of things. I looked on B&H and it was available for delivery the next day. So I was like, you know, I'm just going to buy it and try it and return it if I don't like it. And they launched smartly with a pro lens, a 51.2 RF lens with that system. So I bought that lens at the same time. And, you know, I basically the first few days with that camera, I literally would like, I knew something had potential, and I was falling asleep and waking up the next morning configuring that thing. I was so excited about it, just trying to learn it and dial it in to see if, like, could this really actually be what I was waiting for? And it was. Like, after 2 weeks, I shot a few weddings with the EOS R and the 51.2, and then adapted lenses with the older EF mount, and ended up selling all my Nikon stuff. Eventually. And, you know, I love the Nikon D850. Like, I still think that was sort of the pinnacle of DSLRs, but the EOS R was a few key features that just rocked for me were like edge-to-edge focus points, and the flippy screen that articulates in more than just the one direction was ended up being really valuable. So, yeah, that was sort of the transition in a nutshell. It was a leap of faith. It's been great to see Canon launching a lot of professional lenses. Like, every few months I'm seeing a new one, and they're incredibly expensive, which sucks.
And way bigger than I anticipated.
Way bigger and heavier than you would think. But I actually like that they're not getting too fixated on mirrorless being a portable, like, super small, lightweight solution. Like, I don't really care about that so much. Lightweight would be nice, but I don't mind something being really small and compact. I want awesome quality if that's the trade-off. I want quality over portability. Yeah, I got my iPhone for that. So
yeah. So coming to your workshop, that was one of my takeaways, that I had always shot through the viewfinder and I had never really shot live view. And then,
so you probably came when I was still shooting Nikon live view, maybe the D750. Do you remember what camera I was using?
I think it was 750. And yeah, it was, as I guess, a shift. Now that so many of the cameras have electronic viewfinders, it's more of kind of a natural. It seems more normal to shoot live view now.
Yeah.
But at the time, maybe you were like the only person as an active wedding photographer that was doing it. And I thought that it was great because you could actually, like, my issue is when you're through the viewfinder, you're really just kind of, you're in the scene, but you don't have that full perspective. And when you pull the camera away, you can actually see your framing a little bit better.
Absolutely. There's something, I think, if you think, like, literally think about, when your camera's up inside a viewfinder, the amount of movement your eye has to go to see something in, like, the upper left down to the bottom right. That's a lot of movement. It's like looking at a giant, you know, depending on the magnification of your viewfinder and all that, it's like looking at a theater screen, versus when you pull away and you've got this nice little window in live view where you can really assess and make decisions about your composition, like, quickly, because you have it all there. Like, the amount of movement it takes for your eye to go from the upper left to the bottom right when it's just a tiny little screen. You know, there's trade-offs, though. You have to be more particular about your focus and make sure, you know, it's everything's the way you want. But that, and then combined with a real-life preview of what the bokeh is doing, you can't ever get that with the optical viewfinder. The surface area of what the prism or the mirror is reflecting onto the prism of what the viewfinder shows you in a DSLR will never allow. Even if you're shooting wide open, it will never show you what that bokeh looks like unless you're using live preview, direct from the sensor, what the sensor's seeing. And then, of course, exposure preview and all of that is, I don't even meter anymore with like the plus minus meter. I just look at my damn screen and that's it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there's so many benefits. And I feel like when, you know, you get such a great comprehensive sense of what you're getting in real time, that frees up a lot of mental headroom for you to focus on more creative aspects of the shot with the lighting and posing and chemistry with your client. Like, yeah, it just immediately starts you from a higher level versus, you know, not.
My, like, the thing that I guess I've kind of learned the most is now that I shoot a little more live view is essentially that when I'm shooting through my viewfinder, I never really knew, like, the best photo. I would be like, oh, that's a great photo. And then I would get home and it would never be the best one.
Right.
But when you're actually seeing what you're taking,
right,
you know when you have the shot. Whereas I was always a little bit uncertain with that.
It feels, I mean, there's a reason like studio photographers shot tethered and continue to shoot tethered to a laptop, because when it's like right there on your screen, like you can start to make assessments and adjustments in real time that you just don't pick up on through the viewfinder. I mean, there are advantages. I do miss the viewfinder sometimes. Like if you're, for example, shooting in a really bright contrasty scene and you have to underexpose to retain highlights or something, like I wish there was a way to quickly jump to optical so I could still see what my subject was doing and all of that. But there are ways you can compensate for that. You can just set your exposure. Yes, everything is underexposed in the preview, but then look at the couple or your subject like in real life and you know, manage it that way. But yeah, sometimes I miss it, but hardly. Yeah. Once, especially once you get used to it, like it just becomes second nature. But you know, like I said, the Canon. I tried every Sony mirrorless camera since the A7, like all the way through the lineup, and it took a while for Sony to launch like native pro Sony lenses. Like they were really only in the last 3 years, I think, really started to launch like great prime lenses. And what, 6-7 years ago, they launched the A7, and it just, for whatever reason, I was never able to jump to Sony. There was always some hang up with, again, the lenses or maybe the color or just the feel. They've improved a lot on how it feels in your hand, but that's all really important. Like, you want it to be a good, fun experience shooting.
Yeah.
And for whatever reason, the EOS R just did everything good enough and then a few things exceptionally. And that's all I need in a workhorse. It's not completely lacking anything that's make or break for me.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
There's, I think one of the SLR Lounge guys, I was talking to him, and his theory of specifically why Sony gained so much market share was simply because there's very few physical camera shops, and everyone, if you're ordering by specs and you're seeing what the specs are and you're ordering online, you have that camera, you purchase that camera before you actually hold it in your hands.
Right.
So I'm curious if Sony would have rapidly gained such market growth had camera stores still been the thing.
I don't know. People are really fixated on specs. And on paper, the Sony stuff, I mean, just slays. Even in practice, the autofocus is superior. Like, most of the things that people are frustrated with as photographers, like, Sony has better technology right now. But it doesn't, there's no considering the entire experience as to how you see things, what you're comfortable with as a photographer. Like, yeah, you need like in-store or like actual practical. Like I said, it took me, even with the EOS R, a couple weeks before I was convinced. And it's tough to break away from one system to the next. And I have, like, just to clarify, no brand loyalty whatsoever. I love not being tied to, I've been tempted with certain affiliate, you know, agreements or sponsorships and stuff. And it's like, it's really tempting, but everyone's kind of leapfrogging here and there. And there's always like one person at the top and then another company comes in. Like, I want whatever's working best for me. So just to make sure that's known, I don't work for Canon or anything like that. It's been a fantastic system. And then I've just been lucky that Canon seems to have a roadmap that's emphasizing professional lenses. And now with the R5 that we'll go look at in just a second.
Oh, true.
Yeah, it's here somewhere.
All right.
We'll,
I forgot.
We'll be able to see if that's going to, I think that's truly like their professional offering now.
Yeah.
The EOS R has always sort of been prosumer. Professional lenses are rolling out for it, but the body itself, they definitely handicap, which is good because, I mean, you know, they needed maybe a couple years of learning. You know, they launched with that touch bar, the M-Touch. That thing sucks. Like, I never used that. It was poorly implemented. I like to see the innovation of something new like that as an interface, but it totally flopped.
Yeah.
So I'm glad that they maybe kind of tried stuff and withheld some of the more professional features for the R5 when they can dial it in. The control wheel is back on that camera, so I'm excited to see. And I never shot Canon stuff before that, so I never actually used the control wheel. Nikon didn't ever have it, so Yeah. All right.
Last question. As a wedding shooter, I know that this question comes up a lot. One card slot. What are your thoughts on this?
So I always, I'm a little more relaxed about it now that I shoot with Sony, the tough cards. Yep. Those things seem pretty rock solid. But I essentially, basically for the last 2 years, treated my memory card as if it was internal memory to the camera. 256 gigabytes. I shoot two bodies, most of the time one body throughout the day, but I still had a second body for like the ceremony and other things. So there's some redundancy there in coverage, but when I got home, when I import direct from camera. So there's no mounting or unmounting the memory card for my camera. And then I feel like that's, I'm quite sure, the highest risk point of failure is when you're mounting and unmounting. If you don't properly eject, there's some like writing occurring when you pop it out of your card, like, or pop it out of your camera. So leaving it in camera, connecting over USB-C directly to my computer is how I'd import and kind of mitigate that risk of corruption. And never had a problem. It's been great. So for me, one card slot's not a big deal. I shot for years with a D700. That was one card slot. Nobody complained. You know, always appreciate the redundancy, but it's not, you know, people just are a little spoiled now. Like, it's, people still shoot film, you know, they're shipping that off to a lab, trusting UPS or whatever with these critical wedding photos. Like, that's
terrifying.
Way higher risk
terrifying.
Than a single card slot on a digital camera. And if I ever had a digital card corrupt, which I have had in my Nikon days, very rare, but occasionally, it was always recoverable, as long as you didn't shoot over, you know, an accidentally formatted card or something. Yeah, it was always recoverable. So, for me, problem really didn't exist. Now the R5, of course, that'll have dual slots. And
exciting time.
Yeah, exciting time. Yeah, it's cool. It's nice to see so many, like, Sony making such a big disruption in the market, and same with sort of Fuji. It's like, it's good. It's holding, it's lighting a fire under all these companies' kind of asses to keep them accountable and innovating. So hopefully.
Cool. Yeah. Well, that is all from here at WPPI. Thanks for joining us. Follow Sam. There's links in the description for where you can find him. Introvert.
To do with it.
Yeah, that's good. All right. See you next time. I don't know how to end things ever.
Yeah.
Just like trails off awkwardly. Yeah.